use results in a reduction of SSD lifetime and performance degradation. So the main question, why yet another file system? If we trying to consider what we have currently as available file system, it's something like InnoFS2. It's focused mostly on reliability. F2FS, it's mostly focused on performance. BigCacheFS focused on reliability and performance. And important problem, important goal, prolong SSD lifetime. So SSDFS, the first goal is prolong SSD lifetime. Second goal, it's guarantee strong reliability. And finally, guarantee stable performance. These are three important goals of SSDFS. So how SSDFS can achieve this? First of all, SSDFS is flash friendly, open source kernel space file system, and goal of prolonging SSD lifetime can be achieved by decreasing write amplification, by excluding garbage collector overhead, and by means of decreasing retention issue. So write amplification can be decreased by using compression, compaction scheme, delta encoding. Garbage collector overhead can be excluded by means of excluding FTL garbage collector responsibility, by means of minimizing garbage collector activity on file system side. Strong critical reliability can be guaranteed by checksumming support, metadata application, snapshot support, and stable file system performance can be achieved by means of employing parallelism of multiple NumDies, excluding garbage collector overhead and minimizing write amplification. So if we take a look at the SSDFS architecture, first of all, every SSDFS volume contains segments. Segment is a logical concept. It's every segment always located in the same position of the volume. And this is guarantee, and this is a way to implement logical extent concept. It means that if we store some logical block into some segment, then this logical block will always located in the same segment, never will be moved in another segment. And this provides a way to not to update, for example, block mapping information. And it's one of the important way to decrease write amplification. So there are several types of segments that SSDFS is using, and the goal of this to aggregate in the same segment the same type of metadata or data and to manage this data in more efficient way. So every segment contains one or several logical arrays blocks, and logical arrays block is something like basis for migration scheme, migration stimulation, and this is the way how it's possible to eliminate garbage collector overhead. Any logical block can be mapped to any physical arrays block, and this is one of the important points that can provide the way to implement migration scheme and migration stimulation. So finally, every arrays block contains some number of locks, and every log contain some block mapping, offset transition table, payload, and this provides a way to use compression, compaction scheme, and delta encoding. And this is a way of decreasing write amplification. So first of all, metadata structures of SSDFS start from super block. There is special type of segment that contains actual some sequence of superblock states, and for every mount and mount operation, it is stored something like actual state of superblock. Also, additionally, every log contains copy of superblock information. So finally, superblock is metadata structure that heavily replicated between erase blocks. So second important metadata structure is mapping table. Mapping table responsibility to map or associate logical arrays block with physical arrays block. And second important goal to implement migration scheme by means of association to arrays block into migration sequence. Third important metadata structure is segment bitmap. Segment bitmaps keeps information about state of every segment, and it's easy to find clean segment or dirty segment that can be erased or trimmed or something. And it's possible to find, for example, there are using state of segment, use state of segment, so it's possible to find segment in different state, and this can be used by garbage collector. So next important metadata structure, or the rest of metadata structure, it's represented in the form of B3s. The first is inodes, B3 that contains inodes, and every inode could contain dentists B3 or extends B3. And it also can be used, for example, extended reduced B3. But initially, SSDF is trying to store some user data or metadata in line without using dentist B3 or some allocated logical blocks. And if it's not enough space in inodes, and finally, it needs to create some B3 or allocate logical blocks for user data. So there are three types of segments for B3 nodes. It's leaf node segment, hybrid node segment, index node segment, and the same leaf node segment could contain nodes from different B3s. It means that if we are doing something like flush, metadata flush, so updates from different metadata structures will be aggregated into one segment, or maybe several ones, but it's something like aggregations that provides a way to manage data or metadata updates in an efficient way. So it was a used special testing use case scheme. First of all, it was a used metadata use case and user data use case. For metadata, it was create, update, delete empty file. For user data, it was used create, update, delete file. It was used several sizes of files, 64, 16K, 100K. For SSDFS, it was used also three sizes of RAS blocks, 128 kilobytes, 512 kilobytes, 8 megabytes. And finally, it was used multiple mount and mount scheme. It means that, for example, if you need to create something like 100 or 1,000 or 10,000 files, the whole operation was split on some number of iterations. And during one iteration, we create 10 files, 100 or 1,000 files. And multiple mount and mount approach was used to guarantee that file system cannot hide or something, all, for example, dirty metadata, dirty user data will be flushed, and we can see the total number of read IO requests and write IO requests without any hidden something. So it was used, it was tested all these use cases, but currently I'm ready to share only create empty file use case. So about methodology, first of all, the first goal of SSDFS prolong SSD lifetime. So it needs to suggest some scheme of estimation lifetime of SSD device, because if you can compare, for example, how long can be lifetime for one file system, we can compare with another one, and then we can make conclusion, can some file system prolong lifetime or not. So first of all, we need to use something like RAS limit, because every SSD contains some number of RAS block, some capacity, and every RAS block has a limit for RAS operation. So finally, multiplication of capacity on this limit can provide some RAS limit for the whole SSD. Next, we need to estimate how many RAS operation can use case generate, some total number of RAS operation. And if we divide limit on total number of RAS operation for some use case, we can calculate, for example, how many times some use case can be repeated for this file system. And if some file system can repeat the same use case more times, so it means that file system can prolong SSD lifetime more. So if we are talking about total number of RAS operations, so we need to take into account how many RAS operations can generate flash translation layer, for example, garbage collector of FTL, how many trim operations can initiate file system, how many operations can generate garbage collector on file system side, read disturbance could also generate some RAS operations, and retention issue could also need in some RAS operations. So if you are talking about FTL GC, so it means that we need to estimate amount of in-place updates, because all in-place updates, it will be responsibility of flash transition layer. We can estimate this as difference between the total number of write IO requests and payload. What is payload? Payload is something like some unique number of RS blocks minus time operation. So something like some number of RS blocks that was updated during the whole use case minus in-place updates. So we can estimate garbage collector activity by means of, for example, difference between payload size and valid data size. It's, of course, it's something like not exactly accurate estimation. It's something like more upper bound estimation, because first of all, it's not so easy to estimate valid data amount because file system using different techniques, but it's possible to make some assumption. And for example, this difference can show, for example, potential activity of garbage collector, because it's possible to imagine that every valid block that was invalidated during update operations could be located into some RS block that contains another valid data, and in something like worst case, all this valid data needs to be moved. So finally, it potentially can generate some significant amount of activity. So read disturbance can be estimated like division the whole total number of read operation on some threshold. Retention issue can be estimated like a division of duration of use case on 3 months duration, and multiplication with portion of time on payload size. So we have pretty ready methodology to estimate, for example, SSD lifetime. So first of all, take a look at the write and request case. So SSDFS is using compaction scheme, compression is using delta encoding. But for the case of for this testing, delta encoding hasn't been used. So usually it was used mostly compression and compaction scheme. And this is the way how SSDFS can decrease write amplification, decrease some amount of write requests. It's possible to see that SSDFS behaves in a pretty efficient way. And mostly only NeoFS2 can compete with SSDFS, but mostly for something like 10 on 10,000 or 100 on 10,000 use cases, because in this case, especially for big RS blocks, SSDFS can generate significant number of partial logs, and it means that it could be created significant amount of additional metadata. First of all, delta encoding hasn't been used. And another point that usually, if you're talking about 10 on 10,000, it means that we are using multiple mount-on-mount operations, that it's not a real life use case. For real life use case, we never do such a significant amount of mount operations. So for real life use cases, SSDFS looks better even for NeoFS2 case. And especially for, because currently we're talking about metadata, especially for user data, I'm expecting SSDFS could look much better than NeoFS2. So SSDFS is using migration schema, migration stimulation technique. This is the main way to exclude garbage collector overhead. And one of the evidence of this, is the amount of time operations, because the point here, that namely pressure of regular I requests in migration scheme and migration stimulation do the main activity for moving valid data from exhausted RS block into clean one. And it's possible to see that this technique is pretty efficient, because for example, this technique provide opportunity to trim to erase all invalidated. First of all, alter this block can be validated efficiently. And second point, if it's completely invalidated migration scheme, you know, migration is finished, then this race block can be erased or trimmed. And it's possible to see that this technique works pretty efficiently. So why this technique doesn't work for some use cases? It's because, for example, if you are talking about 8 megabyte race block, so the amount of operation is not enough to finish or even start migration. So in this case, trim doesn't happen. The same, for example, for some use cases for smaller race blocks. It means that, for example, it was not enough operations to finish migration. And this is why I'm using, for example, multiple mount and mount approach, because namely this way provides a way to see how, for example, trim policy is working, not wait long time, because, for example, namely multiple mount and mount operation provides a way to see that this policy can work efficiently. And especially it's possible to see that, for example, even multiple mount and mount operation cannot affect trim policy. This policy can work efficiently. I believe that it's not so for F2FS and FS2, because for this case, a garbage collector can be affected by so short, for example, time of mount operation. So this is, I think, pretty good point. So if we would like to consider payload, so first of all, again, SSDFS is using compression, compaction scheme, and this is first point to initiate smaller number of writer requests. It means that we store smaller amount of metadata or user data, for example. But second point, second player in payload, it's something like trim policy. And for example, if this compaction scheme, compression plus trim policy works together. So finally, we can see that SSDFS is capable to create smaller payload. And we can see that SSDFS can generate bigger payload for some use cases because trim policy doesn't work for these use cases because it was not enough enough operations of write operation to start or finish migration summaries blocks. So, but in average, SSDFS mostly looks much better than other file system, and mostly for most use cases, it could be could create smaller payload. So, especially for real life use cases, because it was used something like multiple mount and mount operations, and for this case, SSDFS could be not so efficient. But it's not a real life use case. In for example, for smaller erase blocks, for example, SSDFS could work much better. But again, it depends from use case, it depends from environment and so on. So for estimate SSD lifetime, we need to estimate FTL garbage collector activity. And first of all, SSDFS doesn't create this responsibility of FTL, garbage collector FTL, because it's pure LFS file system. But for example, for LF2FS, NILFS2, and other file system, they create this responsibility, and it's possible to see that F2FS creates pretty significant responsibility of or necessity to manage situation on FTL side. In LFS2, because it has place update area, and NILFS has two super block in the beginning and volume, and ending of the volume. And this super block updates in place, so it also creates some responsibility. So F2FS, NILFS2 has garbage collector on file system side. And this is something like try to estimate upper bound of possible overhead or possible operations that garbage collector on file system side can generate. It's not completely accurate data because it's possible to say that this estimation between zero and this upper bound, I think that potentially the real overhead could be between these two lower bound and upper bound, but it's something like potential upper bound of this possible operation on garbage collector side. It's possible to see that F2FS generate significant amount, or could generate significant amount of garbage collector activity. But again, F2FS and UFS tool using such policies that the garbage collector start to work until doesn't work until achieving some threshold. So finally, it creates some retention issue. So if we consider write amplification, so how we can estimate decreasing write amplification? For example, we can we have numbers for write a request. We can add to this number estimation of garbage collector overhead on file system side. It's mostly for UFS to F2FS. And for SSDFS case, you can do the same, but for SSDFS, no garbage collector request. So we can, for example, divide total number of file requests write plus garbage collector and divide on write amount of write request for SSDFS. And in this case, we can see write amplification ratio and we can estimate how SSDFS can decrease write amplification issue. And it's possible to see that SSDFS can decrease write amplification significantly. Even a lower bound really looks pretty good. But this lower bound usually for multiple mount mount operations. So it's for real life use cases, this number should be, and it's possible to see that even now that it's pretty better than other fault systems. So if we take a look into read IO request, so in this case, because SSDFS it's log structured fault system, it's using logs, and there is some price for this because in this case, it needs to read slightly more, or maybe more than other file system can do. So SSDFS looks better like UFS2. It looks comparatively same like XFS, but currently SSDFS generates bigger amount of read requests, and sometimes for big RIS blocks, it can affect currently performance. And the main contributor to this is offset transition table. So currently offset transition table has some issue because currently this table distributed between multiple logs. And if you would like to build offset transition table for some RIS block or for some segment, it needs to read all logs, to check all logs, for presence actual state of portions of offset transition table. As a result, it creates a lot of read IO requests for some use cases, but there is a solution. It's possible to store full offset transition table in every log, to use compression to store this transition table in compact manner, and it's possible to achieve bigger improvement for this, and it can decrease number of read IO requests, and also it's possible to use binary search to find latest log. So there is a way to decrease number of read IO requests, and it's a pretty interesting way how SSDFS can be improved. So retention issue estimation shows that, for example, SSDFS looks better for mostly for all use cases, but for some use cases, it's possible to see that it could looks like not so good. But there is an interesting point here because when I'm trying to estimate a retention issue, I'm using, for example, time. I'm using duration of use case. But for some use cases, for example, 10 on 10,000, so it's multiple mount-on-mount operation, it creates a lot of partial logs, and it creates a lot of read operations. And finally, read operations affect or make duration of use case longer, and it creates, for example, bigger retention issue estimation. So if, for example, offset transition table issue is with offset transition table will be solved. In this case, it decreases amount of read IO request, it improves situation with duration of some use cases, and retention issue will be smaller. And in this case, for all file system, SSDFS will be better comparing with all file systems. So finally, we can combine all the numbers, we can combine all the estimations into final number that can show, for example, how SSD first can prolong SSD lifetime. So some use cases doesn't provide good numbers for this estimation, because for some use cases, retention issue estimation and read disturbance estimations define the number for SSD lifetime. And these numbers mostly makes SSDFS better, but better significant amount of time. So I decided not to use these numbers. I decided to use the most reliable numbers. And this number shows that as minimum SSDFS can provide SSD lifetime 2 times for real life use cases, even a lower bound value, showing that, for example, compared with X4 and F2FS, it could be 1.4 times bigger SSD lifetime. But in real life, it will be significantly bigger. So it's possible to see that SSDFS can prolong lifetime of SSD. So it's possible to see that mostly for some use cases, for example, if we have a smaller number of mount-on-mount operation, in this case, SSD has pretty the same comparable duration with other whole system. But as I mentioned already, for the case of, for example, multiple mini mount-on-mount operations, something like 10 on 10,000 case, in this case, SSDFS needs to read a lot. And in this case, this affects performance, or read path affects SSDFS performance. So it's possible to see that because it's log-based file system, SSDFS using logs, and finally, this is a price that it needs to read multiple information, a lot of information from logs, and finally, SSDFS looks like read dominant. However, it needs to mention that first of all, SSDFS has been tested in debug mode. It means that it used debug messages, and it also increased, for example, duration of some use cases. SSDFS still has not fully optimized code, but even now SSDFS performance look comparable with other file systems. But if the problem, the issue with offset transition table will be solved, then situation can be significantly improved. Because if we can generate smaller amount of write requests, so it means that we can be faster. The problem currently simply because SSDFS generate a lot of read I requests, and it's possible to solve this issue by means of solving problem with offset transition table. And then numbers will be significantly better. So another question, is SSDFS zoned in SSD array? So from architectural point of view, yes, it's completely ready because first of all, it's pure log struct file system. It's possible to use logical LRS block equal in size to zone. So from architecture point of view, no troubles. But from the implementation state, it needs to make some implementation efforts to fully support zone namespace SSD, especially because it's possible to have something like unaligned zone size. It's possible to have a limited number of open active write pointers. So in this case, it needs to use slightly more smart technique for SSDFS. It's not big trouble, but it requires some implementation efforts. So the rest is pretty no troubles at all. And it needs to solve problem with offset transition table, and everything looks pretty good from my point of view. So what about future work? First of all, because I shared only create empty file case, it needs to process the rest of benchmarking results and to share information or results for update, delete case for metadata and for user data. So to prove that for other use cases, SSDFS looks better too. It needs to fix issue with offset transition table, Of course, there are bugs in current implementation. It needs to fix these bugs. It needs to, for example, to make some implementation to support zone namespace SSD. It needs to finish snapshot support because it's an implementation with functionality, the application support is an implementation. It needs to finish recoverFS implementation and file system check utility implementation. So this is about future work. As a conclusion, it's possible to see that SSDFS can generate smaller amount of write requests, and this is the way to decrease write amplification issue. SSDFS introduced highly efficient in policy, and this is the way to decrease retention issue. SSDFS is capable to create smaller payload. Again, it depends from RAS block size and depends from use case, the amount of write request and so on, but it can be smaller because of compaction, compression, delta encoding, and efficient trim policy. So SSDFS doesn't create FTL garbage collector responsibility because it's pure log storage file system without any in place of data array. And this is also created zone namespace SSD compatible. So SSDFS mostly doesn't create garbage collector I request because of migration scheme and efficient trim policy. There is only one use case that garbage collector need to participate. If, for example, two RAS block stuck in migration because, for example, some data could be cold or maybe warm and migration could start, but, for example, no enough write a request to finish migration. In this case, garbage collector can help. So we can see that SSDFS decreases write amplification, SSDFS capable introduce smaller retention issue, and finally, SSDFS can prolong SSD lifetime as minimum 2 times, but I think that could be real. It's possible to say that SSDFS can prolong lifetime more, for example, 10 times, but again, it depends from use case. It depends, for example, what file system we compare and so on. But I believe that SSDFS even now looks pretty good and can show pretty good numbers. So it's everything that I have now. Thank you for attending this talk.